Okay, apologize for getting started late. We're going to start with non-agenda public testimony. We've got a number of speakers signed up, so we're going to limit it to a minute apiece. David Irving, Richard Parker, Tabitha Whipple, Angel Flores, Estelle Fisher. David, what's the issue? Speak for 3 minutes, please. Yeah, go ahead.
Thank you. The question was, instead of four of our teachers speaking, I'm just going to speak in behalf of 15 of our teachers. So, good evening, board members. Thank you for having us here. My name is Dave Irving. I am a parent and a teacher in San Diego Unified School District. Today, I am here as a teacher from Hoover High School representing 14 teachers who were pink slipped last year. This year, they were rehired into the same jobs as last year, but are getting paid as substitutes instead. Besides a significant cut in salary, these teachers are going to lose their benefits in just a couple of days. Hoover has 14 teachers in this situation, but there are hundreds across the district. As well-educated professionals with years of advanced education, professional development, and most importantly, experience, we have a few questions. First, was it really the intention of this school district to save money by having the salaries of these professionals reduced to sub-rate pay over a one-month period? Secondly, was it also the intention of this school district to save money by not paying for insurance benefits for these teachers for the 1 month that they will be forced to go without it? If it was the district's intention to save money this way, we think this is wrong. Some teachers are pregnant or just had babies or are on regular medications, etc. These things can become monumentally cost prohibitive on a substitute pay and no insurance. If it wasn't the district's intention to save money this way, will you commit to covering the 1 month lapse in insurance these teachers face? Thirdly, if these teachers receive contracts this year, is it true that they will only receive temporary contracts and thus lose their jobs again and any benefits at the end of the school year? Additionally, is it the intention of the school district to wait until next week to inform some of these teachers that their services are no longer needed based on more accurate attendance figures? I personally have never been associated with an organization that treats their employees this way, and I am ashamed that it is happening in the realm of education. At what point is the district willing to make an educated decision and then stand by it in terms of attendance? The district has said that difficult choices needed to be made in order to deal with the inadequate budget it received from the state. We say these decisions are more reckless than difficult. The truly difficult decision would have been to stand up to the state, refuse their budget, and make the case that this district, in its best professional assessment, cannot responsibly provide the education its constituents deserve with the state's budget. The teachers, parents, students would have stood up with you. But it is not too late for you to stand up for what is right. Treat professionals like professionals and hold yourselves and Sacramento to a higher educational standard and truly be willing to make the difficult choices. Use the voice of this school district to refuse the next inadequate budget that is surely on its way and stand up for education, the education that your students deserve, and restore dignity to education. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, board members, superintendent. I'm Bill Freeman. I'm the president of San Diego Education Association. The last 4 years have been really terrible for educators and kids in schools. Educators have been demonized by the media. They've been told that they created an economic crisis by elected officials, many of them, and now Many elected officials are seeking to place their retirements, our retirements, in the hands of their wealthy friends. This has been driven by greed, and we all know that. But we've always had our educational family to fall back on. But now, it seems that they too have fallen to this greed. The district has laid off more than hundreds of permanent educators, citing budgetary shortfalls. And we realize the state has a budgetary crisis. However, all these educators are recalled back to their very own classroom with their very own equipment, their very own students, plus many more. And they are paid 40% less. So we are asking you to take a serious look at that. When we are looking at financial crisis, you have to look at us. We are the district. We are 80, 85%. At some point, we'll have to sit down and work through this. But there is a trust issue that has to be overcome in this. And so I ask you to take a serious look at what you're doing and do the right thing. Put these teachers back in their classroom with the pay that they deserve. Thank you.
Thank you.
If I called your name, please.
Hi, my name... Thank you for having me here. My name is Estelle Fisher, and I am from the Native American community. I am Chimawavy, Tewa, Hopi, and Paiute, and I'm here on behalf of our whole community. We were somebody came in and was hired in a position in which we feel is really sensitive to our culture. We would like somebody to be in there who does have the same background as us so they can understand what we face every day as far as being within our traditions and keeping our traditions. That is really very pertinent to us. And within saying that, I grew up in the San Diego City Schools in the urban area. I went to Lincoln High, where I was the only one Native American there. And I would rather have somebody in there who can actually advocate for us, knowing what it feels like to be that 1% out of 800 students. And Mr. Richard Barrera, I do believe I have met you before. Looking at me, you probably wouldn't even know because where we met was at Cherokee Point Elementary. I'm sure I blended in well with the rest, but that's just an example of our difference. Yeah, we may look alike, but we are different people. We do have a different culture that we stand strongly with, and we would like to preserve that and teach our children to be strong and stand up for what they believe. And within that, the school district had made it to where they were going to hire somebody and put somebody in this position that was going to come from a Native American background, have a child within the school district, but that's not what happened. Now, my question is, was that ever the real intent of the school board? Or are you just looking to cut costs? Because if that's the case, then you're not keeping our traditions and our culture in your mind. And that's what I would like to request from all of you, is that doing that within your decisions, you would just keep us and be considerate of our people. Thank you.
Thanks.
Hey, my name's Richard Parker. I'm a member of the Indian community, and I work for San Diego Unified School District, and my information is on file. I'm just kind of further want to clarify this, that this position was promised to us by the school district. They sent out two letters saying that the community was going to have input on the hiring of this person. The second time, they sent another letter out, said that they were waiting for human resources to approve it. And then we had a parent meeting for the Native Americans, and they brought in another person, non-Native. And the community has been emailing you with the different board members, and no reply from either one of you guys. So, you know, that's just kind of the way that the Native Americans are being treated in this community, is that we're a minority, so they won't say nothing. Well, we are saying something. I think that you guys should be ashamed as far as trying to put the wool over our eyes as far as having a Native American in that position. And I know that I've talked to B. Fernandez and her boss, but, you know, it just kind of, it was a slap in the face, this whole thing. And if it was any other minority group, you would have been up there right on it. But as far as Native Americans, nothing said. That's all I got. Thanks.
Good evening, members of the board, elders, and fellow guests. My name is Tabitha Whipple, and I am from the North Fork Mono Tribe of Central California. I am a graduate of San Diego State University in American Indian Studies, with an emphasis on federal Indian policy, and also a member of the Soaring Eagles Dance Troupe. I am here today in support of an appeal of a recent hiring decision affecting the Title VII Indian Education Program. It is my understanding that an ideal candidate for the position of the director for this unique organization should be familiar with local Indian populations, sensitive to cultural protocol, aware of issues affecting our Indian children, knowledgeable in securing funding opportunities, and above all, a strong leader who will uphold the mission statement of the district and be respected among our students and our community. It is a fact that the national average of American Indian high school graduates within the United States is less than 50%. This is a crisis. This is an issue that our people are facing. And here you have a one-of-a-kind Indian education program that has been thriving for years under Vicky Gambala. But now, its future is uncertain. To fill the position of director with someone underqualified is nothing less than unacceptable. I urge you to reconsider your recent actions affecting the Title VII Indian Education Program. Create a task force that will hold a fair and open hiring process to ensure that our children are getting the very best program director San Diego has to offer. Because at the very least, that's what they deserve. Thank you.
Good to see all of you here. My name is John Hood. I'm from the Navajo Nation, and I'm advocating the Title VII Indian Education as well. A little bit of history. In 1970, President Nixon issued his famous special message to Congress on Indian affairs and laid out a new rationale for a new, more enlightened federal Indian policy, Indian self-determination. He stated in that, "This, then, must be the goal of any new national policy toward the Indian people, to strengthen the Indian's sense of autonomy without threatening his sense of community. We must assure the Indian that he assume control of his own life without being separated involuntarily from the tribal group, and we must make it clear that Indians can become independent of federal control without being cut off from federal concern and federal support." You know, through the years, the American Indians have been subjected to myriads of constraints in the field of education. Diversity is a sensitive element, but a leadership cloak with our culture does enhance and advance our Indian people. Our identity, representation, and our endeavors diminishes when a non-Indian representative takes a leadership role. All efforts to maintain our sacred traditions and values are broken like the treaties of the past. Communication, consultation, and respect are the true element that bonds trust, tolerance, and understanding. Your selective representative by the school board has alienated our community. Your lack of confidence and sensitivity and intolerance is a challenge by the American Indian community. Social justice is deemed impure when the gift of cultural beauty and grace is left to encounter the storms. The American Indians continue to ride the infinite waves of adversities. You know, my son started school back in when he was, he just first entered grade school. It was through the Indian education that he received tutorial from Tadna in education under Ms. Vicky Kimbala. Now my son is a sophomore at Stanford University. This is how far the program has come. And we do need your support. We need an American Indian that could represent us on your school board and every communication there is, and make us a better, strong community and a better bond with the school board. Thank you.
Yeah, go ahead.
Just really quickly, I did respond to Rose at the Indian Times, and I have spoken with Mr. Stover, and we are in fact, I guess, bringing something back to the board really soon to correct what this. It was a mistake that happened because we did shift things around, but that particular position we will be restored, and it's bringing it back by the staff. Okay, so yes, we did. We heard you. Yes, it is.
Did I call your name? Kiana Myla Davis, Lorena Gaslam, Ashley Owen, Bud Goodpaster, Erica Guerin, Nicholas Sincotta.
Manahu, my name is Kiana Malay Davis. I'm from the Lone Pine Paiute Shoshone Reservation. And I like that you heard us. That's great. I just want to just let you know the importance that you guys really look into this position. From a personal experience, I've had those people come and try to educate me about my culture. Back when I was in the fourth grade, I had someone pull me out of class and teach me a dance that had nothing to do with who we were. Someone who was not educated and did not know our background, and it's humiliating. I never want to see our students go through that. It's very difficult when they don't understand where we come from. Sorry. Our children deserve better than that. Our children deserve the best, and they need someone to bridge that gap between our society and the mainstream society. Our kids, when they go to school, they cannot turn to their friends and talk about their culture because they're probably the only two at that school. The Indian education program brings them together and lets them get to know there are others like them. We all come from different reservations, different tribes. We all have unique talents, abilities that we can bring together, and we just want to strengthen our children. We need to get them educated. And we have people in our community who are educated, who can help them, who can guide them. You know, I'm glad that you hear us. I just really want you to know there's a real personal thing to this. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Bud Goodpaster. My address is on file. Mr. Superintendent, President Barrera, school board members, students, families, and staff. Tonight, I'm representing the San Diego Unified School District Counseling and Guidance Governance Team. Members are elected by our district school counselors for volunteer positions to help all counselors best serve our students, families, and staff. The governance team meeting is usually held the fourth Monday of each month in a rotating location, and all school counselors are encouraged to attend and participate. The San Diego Unified School District Counseling and Guidance Governance Team has approved the mission statement that follows the lead and aligns with our school district's mission statement. The counseling department mission statement is, school counselors are leaders and advocates in education by implementing programs focusing on academic development, personal social development, and career planning. School counselors will establish and maintain partnerships with school and community organizations that promote student achievement. This school year, our district is going forward with a career-ready and college preparatory initiative called CRCP. This program will help realize the school district's and the counseling guidance mission statement by helping students and families look to the future with a plan to accomplish the desired goals. The counseling governance team believes that school counselors will play an integral role, that is, in the collaboration and implementation of this initiative. Like all educators, counselors wear a variety of hats. Two of those hats are helping students and families and staff deal with the suicide and self-harm issues, as well as providing support during district or school crises. School counselors continue to play a vital role in the school being implemented by the District Safe Schools Task Force. Our school counselors are qualified and eager to work with students, families, and staff. The increase in reporting issues of possible self-harm indicates students, families, and school staff are comfortable going to counselors for help. Thank you for your support of our counselors.
Hi, good evening. My name is Erica Guerin. I'm a teacher at Hoover High School, and this is my eighth year teaching, but fifth year in the district, and I've been laid off 3 out of the 4 years that I've been here. Normally, I wouldn't let him cry like this in public, but I think this is important. It's okay.
You know, I love my job. It's the hardest thing I've ever done in my entire life, and I have had other jobs. And I think it's ridiculous that right now, you know, not only are we suffering because our benefits are ending in 3 days and we're not getting paid for what we're all doing our jobs like we normally would, attending open house and having parent conferences and staying after school to help kids, but yet, you know, we're only recognized as a sub, and it makes me feel like I'm being walked all over. And it just worries me that this is going to get worse and worse and worse, and our public education system is going down the tubes. And that's what I worry about most, because I know I could find a job doing something somewhere else, but the public education system is not going to last if this is the way it goes. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Lorena Gastelum, and I'm an English teacher at Hoover High School. It's my third year at Hoover. I'm going into debt to keep my job and to be with my kids at Hoover because I'm getting paid as a sub and I'm paying for daycare. In 3 days, my benefits end, and I can't imagine doing anything else. I love my kids so much. But at what point do we have to say enough is enough? Like Erica said, I feel like we're being walked over. I think the expectation is that we're going to continue doing our jobs just the same way that we've always done them. Because we love what we do. So going in there and being treated like we're subs, our kids won't know the difference. But if a sub did go in there, or if they get a different teacher in 2 weeks, if we all get bumped or if we get moved around, I don't think that this is what's best for our kids. So I think when we start thinking about budgets and teachers and people think, well, at least you have a job, that the ultimate goal should be what is best for our kids, and that's not what's happening right now.
Thank you, first of all, for hearing us. This is now my third year in the district, and I was called 2 days before school and informed I would be moving locations. I am now at Hoover High School, where roughly 10% of our teaching staff are working uncontracted as substitutes day to day. We are visited by the Williams Act auditors today, who specifically asked us about former permanent teachers working in vacancies. Our kids are confused, we're confused, parents are confused, and unfortunately you're getting to the point where the district is going to start losing good teachers because they are moving elsewhere where they are appreciated, acknowledged, and their concerns are addressed. So I just hope that you teach all of us as you would teach your own children if they were in our own shoes, and really consider the impacts that your decisions make even 6 months down the line as we're seeing right now. Thank you so much.
One moment, please. You know, with the Indian education, we received $5,000.
Yeah, we can't.
This is important as this as well. Uh-huh. We received $5,000 from Barona and for the Soaring Eagles program, and we had the school board put that into their account, and we don't know what happened to our $5,000, and nobody knows what happened. Can you check into that for us?
Yeah. Okay, thanks a lot. Nicholas Cincotta, Richard Parker, I can't read the last name, Van, something, Philip Liebert, Heather Poland, and E. Gikakis.
I just want to say real quickly, not to comment too much, but what David Irving and the teachers brought up has been duly noted and being looked into.
My name was already called. I just came late. My name was already called, sorry. My name is Angel Flores. I'm speaking for Indian Education.
Yeah.
And recently, Vicky Gambala, she's retired, and she's been replaced with somebody else, and we don't exactly like the person that she's been replaced with because we want somebody that knows our community, because we all know each other. We know what we do. We know everybody knows each other's family. We're all pretty much a big family. And it's like a stranger coming in and taking over something that she has no idea about. And we just would like somebody that is more qualified, more educated to what they're going to be doing, instead of just an office clerk coming in. Yeah, that's it. Thank you.
How's it going? I'm Nick Cinquota. I'm actually a first-year teacher. And when the time came for me to sign a contract, I was offered a leave replacement contract without any information given in terms of what the contract held. After reading thoroughly, I found out it was a leave replacement contract. My concern is this, and I know I'd much rather be working without a contract than be working with a leave replacement contract, worrying about where I'm going to be at day to day than having a leave replacement contract and knowing that I'll be losing my job at the end of the school year. Because building a special education program is difficult anyways, and to build a quality one takes years. When you're not knowing where you're going to be from year to year, it makes it difficult to build a quality program, even in a short year. Because there are a lot of factors to take into account, and getting to know the students, you can only learn so much of the capabilities in a given year.
Good evening, board members and the public. I'm here as a parent of a high school senior, and I want to talk about an incident that was brought to the Area 1 meeting on September 12th at Porter Elementary. A parent got up and said that her daughter was told by a teacher that she's not going to get into college, she's going to work in a fast food. And this follows a similar incident at Fulton Elementary, where a student was seeking help with a math problem. The teacher told the student, why should I waste my time with you? You're going to end up working at Burger King. I don't believe that the board president, the superintendent, or the Bill Freeman and Camille from the teachers union, I don't believe you condone that type of behavior. But I believe that we need to address this. So the people who are the teachers who are paid to stand and teach our children, they don't talk to them in a negative, disrespectful, and disparaging way. And I'm urging parents that if your child is being talked to, you should seek help. I'm not here on behalf of the NAACP, but the NAACP and other groups, the ACLU, Equity Alliance, they will be willing to assist parents to ensure that their students are treated with respect. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Heather Pullen. My information's on file. I'm standing in front of you as yet another example of a certificated teacher of 6 years who's currently working as a substitute teacher in my old placement. In order to open a classroom for my students in time, I, amongst many other teachers, spent the Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and Monday prior to September 6th, morning to night, unpacking a classroom that I unnecessarily packed during the layoffs. I'm currently tutoring students before and after school and teaching a full day, as I did as a contacted teacher, only now to have to run off to a restaurant for 30-plus hours a week to supplement my income, so that I can stay in a career that I love with students that I love. I ask you to consider not only the effect that this has on my students and myself and many, many, many other teachers, but also the long-term effects that this decision has on the success of our district. We need to rectify this problem and fix our wrong before more damage is caused.
Elizabeth Jakakis, parent, teacher. I appreciate what you do as a board. It can't be easy.
Elizabeth, could you just lower your mic a little bit?
Yeah. I appreciate what you just wanted to hear that again.
There you go.
I appreciate what you do as a board. It can't be easy. But I'm also here to talk about the policy of issuing reduction in force papers and then hiring people back in the same place, but at a lower status, as these teachers that have spoken to you as substitutes. And it's dismaying, and it's shocking, as many things going on today are, but this is particularly shocking to me. And I see the teachers day to day at my school. One is right next door to me, and she comes in every day with her teacher, you know, face, and she does her thing because she knows where her responsibilities lie. So I'm here to, as the other people who have spoke to you, to request that you restore our faith in you fully tonight by restoring these teachers to their proper positions. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. I'd like to now ask the Marine Corps JROTC Color Guard from Mission Bay High School to present the colors. Please stand. Ready, begin. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. I'd like to welcome everyone present today and those watching the broadcast and call the September 27, 2000 regular meeting to order with four board members present. If you wish to address the board today and your name is not on the blue sheet located at both entrances to the auditorium, and if you've not already submitted a request for public testimony form, please complete the form and submit it to Ms. Ward. Speakers on agenda items will be called on to speak during the discussion of the agenda item. Once the discussion begins on an item, no additional public speaker requests will be accepted. Non-agenda item testimony was heard at 5 p.m. and will also be heard at the end of the meeting. At this time, I'd like the ASB student representatives to the board to introduce yourselves. Please tell us about yourself and what's going on at your school, both academically and socially. And we'll start with Donner Good, our ASB council president from Patrick Henry High School.
Thank you. As you mentioned, I'm the newly elected president of the ASB President Council, a group of ASB presidents within our district that comes together. We discuss and resolve conflicts that are happening within our district, and also we brainstorm to make sure our ASBs on campus are working better, we have better ideas, and also that we can come together for similar problems and come together as a whole. Also, I'm the ASP president at Patrick Henry High School, where we're trying to get the students more involved as well. We are looking forward to our homecoming at West Hills. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, Tom. And Zara Joyce Abuyu from ASB, the ASB president from Morse High School.
Hi, I'm Zara Joyce Abuyu. Like what Donner said, as an ASB president, we help each other out and talk about the issues that's going around. I'm the vice president of the student council, as well as the ASB president of Morse High. And like others, ASB presidents, we're getting ready for our homecoming game and homecoming dance, as well as the opening of our new field and our new bleachers. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, guys. And now, Dr. Meyer, we will do our student presentation, the Mira Mesa High School Band.
Yes, I would like to ask Dr. Evans to introduce the Mira Mesa Band, and I believe we have the band coordinator here.
Okay, we're fortunate to have a small part of the Mira Mesa High School Band has 160 members, and as you can see, they won't fit in here, so we have about 30 here today. And I saw them, was with them last summer at the 4th of July parade, and I just want to have the leader, Ms. Jean Christensen, introduce them.
Thank you so much. It's our pleasure. Thank you, Dr. Evans, for inviting us to come down and represent. Yes, 160 was just going to be real too loud in here. Yep. But at this moment, we'd like to bring in our 37 that we have here today, kind of think of them as a pep band to get your meeting started.
All right. right. Well, thank you, Ms. Snell. That's definitely going to get us going. Thanks very much. Okay, Mr. Barnett has a recognition to present. I'm sorry, that was...
Is Caitlin Snell here?
Okay.
Is this on?
Yes. Caitlin has a remarkable achievement, and she's been appointed to the California State Board of Education as a student representative for 2011-2012, and she is currently the ASB president at Point Loma High School. Now, clearly, she's very smart to get appointed to a board instead of have to run for a board like the rest of us, but could you tell us a little bit about how you got appointed to the board and actually what they do?
Absolutely. So I received an email from our school's program, Naviance, about the opportunity, and so I filled out the application just on a whim, thought it was a great chance to, you know, make change in my state, and I filled out the application, and I was selected as one of the top 12, so they flew me to Sacramento, and I did some impromptu speeches and some interviews and ended up making it to the next round. I said, oh, okay, this is pretty cool, and then I was chosen to go to the next round, and then I ended up being appointed by the governor of California, and it's been a great opportunity so far. I had my first meeting on the second and third day of school, September 7th and September 8th, and I go up there every other month for the meetings. I'm a full voting member, and we deal greatly with charter schools, all the policies. We're working on adapting the Common Core standards, and it's just been a great opportunity to evoke some change in my state, and I hope that I can represent the students of California the best I can. So thank you.
All right.
And because Caitlin is tall, we're going to have the board members take another step
back. Okay, that's
no offense.
So we know who to lobby if we want.
Right. We've got an insider now.
All right, and one, two, three. And I'm going to take just one more here from this side.
There we go.
We don't want the screen in the background. Yeah, there we go. One, two, three. All right.
Can I grab one, guys?
Same thing. One, ready? Count three. One, two, three.
Can mom get one real fast?
Sure.
Okay. Yeah, mom it.
Can we get mom?
Mom.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Good call. Good call. Mom, you want to get it?
I thought mom wanted to be in the picture.
Oh.
No. This is her path.
Great.
Well, thank you again. Thank you.
Well, that is exciting. So now we will move on to our superintendent's information report. Superintendent Koba.
Thank you, President Barrera. First off, I have three assignments to announce. Elizabeth Castillo Duval to principal at Crown Point Elementary School. Anisha Dalal to human resources officer. And John Ross to vice principal at Lincoln High School. If I could, I'll move to superintendent comments. The last couple of weeks, which are the school opening and kickoff events, I think, for much of the school year, resulted in a number of different one-of-a-kind visits. I had an opportunity to speak on a panel before the League of Women Voters to discuss federal education and associated programs from funding to Common Core. And I want to bring that up as a point of advocacy and certainly talking to the League leadership team about how we could blend together. We know that they're very strong advocates for transitional kindergarten, preschool, school as well as K to 12. So we had that discussion at the Sarah Mason Public Library. Another form of advocacy, interestingly, is the Union Tribune had a press conference that we participated in at the Farb Middle School. This was in conjunction with kicking off what is a volunteer Union Tribune Volunteers for Education campaign. They are partnered with the United Way of San Diego County, which is seeking to generate a volunteer base to come out into public schools throughout the county, and this is the Union Tribune's own contribution. And obviously, they are a supporter, a community interest group, an advocate in many ways, and a source of communications. So, a valuable alignment there. A couple of other partnerships. We met with the new San Diego State University president, Dr. Elliot Hirschman, to talk about a variety of partnership issues, everything from admissions policies consideration for unified district 12th graders, and as well as teacher preparation and programs available for our staff in terms of aspiring administrators and doctoral programs. And I think that's the beginning of a very good, very solid university link that we will have in the future. Other partnership discussion is meeting with the City Heights Partnership for Children, a forum that is being sponsored by San Diego State as well as Price Charities, to take another look at the Hoover Cluster Feeder Pattern and how we can align on a much broader level. It's about health agencies, school district, law enforcement, California Endowment, a very broad, diverse group of people coming together with a single purpose in mind, and that's elevating the educational experience for the Hoover Cluster. And I think that's a model that we could watch very closely. Some other, I think, partnership, I had the opportunity to speak with the PTA Council. That's all of the representatives. Did that last night. We walked through issues of the moment, also asked for their assistance and advocacy, shared with them that the board and I have gone forward with correspondence such as to the governor with regards to opposing any mid-year trigger cuts to education, and there are other options for certainly articulating the case for public education. And the last thing I want to bring up is with the community college district. We're going to have a meeting this week to talk about ongoing discussions and alignment between the San Diego Unified School District and the San Diego Community College School District. But there's a event prior to that. I had the opportunity to attend their board meeting last week, where they showcased different programs across their four campuses, and the one that was selected for showcasing by the City College was in fact our San Diego Early Middle College program. So the entire board at the school district, the Community College School District, had the opportunity to hear how well we are working, the college faculty, the high school faculty, and the kids, to make a difference. And this is with a large student population of students with the first opportunity to go to college, a 90% plus children of diversity and of poverty, all exceeding expectations in a community college setting. So a lot of different types of opportunity for validating or introducing our partnerships as the school year opens. That's all I have.
Great. Thank you, Superintendent. Board information reports, Dr. Evans.
Okay, I just want to report very quickly. I was very pleased to see over the last couple of years how the cluster councils have really developed into strong entities supporting our schools as advocates, as groups that are advising the board on their positions on various issues, and people who are rolling up their sleeves to really improve the schools in their own communities. In Claremont, both Claremont Cluster and Madison Cluster have been working very hard this year, and both of them simultaneously pretty much had the grand opening of their football stadiums with the Friday Night Lights, and that was a very, very exciting event for the community to come together. A lot happening also in University City, who is going to have the same event in the next year. And then I met last night with the Mira Mesa Cluster, and a lot of things moving forward. One is working on a community schools agreement where all the entities, the administration, the community, the district, the teachers' union, the teachers at the school have all worked together to see how they can form a coalition to really continue the improvement of the schools in Mira Mesa that are already that are already performing very high, and so that's very good. And a lot of times also in these cluster discussions, we get into some more difficult topics. Obviously, there are always budget issues. There are a lot of other more sensitive issues that come up, and I think this is really, really important. We didn't ask for just a smooth ride in terms of having this democratic process, but I think we're able to engage in open and civil discussion about all of the things that are facing our district. And then one other thing, there was a teacher I thought who would be here this evening who didn't make it. We've been talking about having volunteers in the school, and one of our teachers, Suzanne Hagen, who is a teacher, a second grade teacher, I believe, at Dingaman Elementary School, she and another teacher have started a program of going to schools in the Logan, Barrio Logan area, and tutoring after school a couple of days a week, and I'm looking for other teachers and parents to get involved in that, and that's very exciting. So the contact information I can give you is if you contact Suzanne Hagen, an elementary teacher at Dingaman, anyone who wants to get involved in this volunteer program, please do that.
Great. Thanks, Dr. Evans. Ms. Jackson?
First of all, I had a chance to walk the red carpet at Clay Elementary. They acknowledged their students and their faculty for their test scores. Three of their students actually scored 100% on their CST, so that was really exciting. I want to thank the Port Authority earlier this week, this was yesterday, it goes by so quickly, I participated in a listening conversation with them for the development of the port in San Diego, and it was good because they had everyone at the table, not just people that are such with the Port Authority normally, but they had educators, they had community leaders, because they wanted to make sure that all the voices are heard in development of their strategic plan. We had a cluster meeting at Morris, and you heard earlier, but this coming weekend, Friday night, is when they'll get to open their stadium. We heard a lot of complaints for parents late recently because they said our field has been closed for 2 years in order to get their field done, to get their stadium done. But a stadium is truly one of a kind, and so we'll be happy to get that ribbon cut on that particular stage on Friday afternoon. Lincoln, this year, we had our cluster meeting a couple of weeks ago, and while the school is open and we're moving forward, there were some concerns that were addressed, mostly about the math scores. The superintendent is going to come out and address the community at our next cluster meeting, which is October 10th. Wanted to make sure that was put out to the public so they say we sent it, that message, but did he really get it? So he got the message. But in looking at not Lincoln math scores, we put up all the high school math scores, and there is some concern here now, the superintendent, if he would take a moment to look at these scores for these high schools and try to find some kind of plan, because we know that right now in the budget conversation, a lot of our focus is on how to keep our district solvent. But we can't lose focus of our number one priority, which is educating children. And so, but with that, I'm looking forward to Friday night and seeing those awesome bleachers that we have at Morris. Thank you.
All right. Mr. Barnett?
Without going into specific action or specific situations, I did want to generally discuss some of the issues that were brought up tonight by some of the speakers, and certainly emails that all of us have been receiving the last few weeks about the terrible disruption that is going on at school sites, with not only the placement of teachers, but in the personal disruption to people's lives. And I know the fear and the concern that you have as taking care of your families and your children and others is real. And we are not only hearing it through email and otherwise, but I think it's fair to say that the entire district is doing everything it can to address the concerns in a timely and legal fashion. So, but I know that doesn't today remove the fear and apprehension that is genuine, and I'm I'm sorry. All I can say is that the process is so convoluted, so Byzantine through state law and contractual obligations that has resulted in this disruption, which I hope will be resolved very soon for all of you. So we are paying attention to it, and it is a great concern, and just want you to know that it is a major focus of all of us. Thank you.
Okay, and I'll pass. Can we get a motion to adopt the agenda?
So moved.
Second.
In favor? Okay, and do we have any items from the consent agenda that board members wish to pull?
21, yes. Please.
E4, please.
Okay, we got E4.
Oh, and 21. Sorry.
I heard 4 and 21. Any others? Okay, if not, can we get a motion to adopt the rest of the consent agenda?
Second.
All in favor? Okay. Okay, let's move on to item F1, and this is the 2011 Accountability Progress Report. Superintendent?
Thank you, President Pereira. We have another in a series of academic testing outcomes that we want to brief to the board, to the community. I've asked Ron Rohde to come forward. This is a report which brings together the issues of annual progress, of performance index, and it's a blending of the different state and federal outcomes that we want to address with you, and I've asked Ron if he would quickly go through the highlights. You have had detailed reports, memos with supporting documents. So, Ron, over to you.
Thank you, Superintendent. So I just want to... This report brings forward three different components of what the state calls the Accountability Progress Report, and includes our AYP, or Adequate Yearly Progress, the Academic Performance Index Growth Results, and the Program Improvement Results. And I just want to highlight that the results here are a little bit different than the results we've looked at a couple of weeks ago when we looked at the STAR results. For accountability, we exclude certain students who may not have been in schools for the entire year. So if they're not continuously enrolled, they are excluded from accountability results. And, of course, the justification is that if the student is only there a month or two, it's probably not fair to hold a school accountable for the performance of that particular student. And also a few other students who are English learners in United States schools for less than a full academic year are also excluded. So those are the two primary groups of students who are excluded, but again, most of the results in here are based on the STAR results that we looked at previously. So I'm going to go through the different components of here, and the first one is the Adequate Yearly Progress, or AYP, and there are four components the district must meet for this accountability measure. The first is we must test 95% of our students, and the district was successful in that again this year. The second one is our annual measurable objectives, or AMOs, and here the targets jumped up by about 10 or 11 points from last year. So here we are at 67% in English language arts and 67.3% in mathematics. We must also achieve an API score of 710. And lastly, the graduation rate target from the state is 90%, and because we now have 9 years left to make up that difference between where we are, we need to make 1/9 of the difference if we were not at 90%. And also just a reminder about what comprises the AMO, and we, for grades 2 through 8, we essentially have our CSTs, or California Standards Tests, in English Language Arts and Mathematics, as well as the California Modified Assessment, the CMA, and the California Alternate Performance Assessment, the latter two being tests for some of our special education students. One of the key things to remember at high school is that the only tests included are the CAESE results, or the California High School Exit Exam results at grade 10. We call that the census exam, or if students take the CAPA. So it's only those two tests, and it does not include the CSTs at high school. So looking at the results for the AMOs, and just looking at the two middle columns of each of these sections, those are the results for 2011, and you'll notice that in any case where the district did not meet the target, the text is red. And at the very top of each column, note that for all students district-wide, the district did not make those AMOs. This is the first year that the district has not met those overall district AMOs. And also, if you look going down in the ELA column, there's for Pacific Islanders, it's at 58.7, but it is in black text, it's not red. That's a case where that group made it by a provision called Safe Harbor, which means it made enough growth or change over the year, and even though it did not make the actual target. So in this case, there are 14 of our targets in this particular indicator that were missed. And then moving on to API, we had a score of 798. That easily surpassed the target of 710, so we made that indicator. And the last one for our district is the graduation rate. And again, we were at 86.29%, easily meeting our target also of 80.47. This rate is based on the, if we want to call it now, the old method, the NCES method. And as you may remember, when we release graduation rate data in the summer, next year we'll be using the new cohort rate, and that is a much tougher standard to meet. So in summary then, if we look at the district performance, we did not make AYP overall because we missed only the AMO objective. We made the other three. Okay, I'm going to take a quick look at some achievement gap. This is one of the traditional things that we always do with our achievement results. And the story here, unfortunately, is no different than what we've looked at with the STAR results. We do see a little bit of more change for some of our racial ethnic groups, in this case African American and Hispanic, going down by 2 points for African American students and down by 4 points the gaps over the last 5 years. Certainly not enough change that we'd like to see, but we must continue to monitor that and focus some attention on the achievement of our underperforming groups. And we have a similar result for mathematics, where essentially the gaps are nearly the same as they were 5 years ago. And then we would also want to draw your attention to the results for our urban districts across California that we where we do our comparisons. And as you can see, San Diego moved into year three of program improvement if you go across to the final column on the right. We are the last of the districts to move into year three or corrective action. All the other districts were in year three before. There is no a designation beyond year three for districts. Once you hit year three, that's the final plateau, and you, as for schools, they stay in year five. One point of clarification, if we look in the second column, you'll notice did districts make all of their AYP criteria? Not all districts have the same number of targets to meet, and that's generally based on the diversity in the district. So a large district like San Diego has the maximum number of targets, which is 50. Some smaller districts won't have enough students in certain categories. So typically those would be in the Pacific Islander or perhaps the Native American groups where they wouldn't have enough students and therefore would have a reduced number of targets. Now I'm going to switch to the Academic Performance Index Growth Report. And I just want to highlight one difference with this, and remember that for AYP we only look at English Language Arts and Mathematics. The API includes those two subject areas as well as science and history social science, and the API also brings in CAISY results. So it's a much more comprehensive measurement than a
AYP is. And again, we already looked at this. We made 13 points of growth. We met the target with a score of 798, just 2 points shy of 800, that state target. And here we're looking at the results for our various student groups. And of note, all groups did show some increase comparing going from the 2010 base to the 2011 growth, albeit the Filipino only made 1 point of growth. So again, some work to do there with some of our lower performing groups as we move forward. And then turning our attention again to our urban district comparison, there is only one district that is above 800, and that's Garden Grove. San Diego is second to that. And again, we just need two more points to reach that 800 target. And you can see that the growth for San Diego this past year was somewhat in the middle, third among these large urbans with 13 points of growth. And the last section of the Accountability Progress Report is for program improvement. And as I mentioned, the district, by virtue of missing AYP for a third year in a row, is now in year three of corrective action. We also have 113 schools, including district-managed schools and charter schools, that are now in program improvement. We had 25 schools from our watch list last year that missed AYP for a first time, missed it again for a second time this year. They are now in year one. We had 17 schools that were in program improvement last year who made AYP, and four of those schools was for a second year in a row, and they have now exited program improvement. So here we're looking at the schools that did make AYP last year, and you can see the list of elementary, middle, and senior high schools, as well as two charter schools, and those with asterisks are those that exited program improvement based on that second year of making AYP. So that is the quick summary of the results from our Accountability Progress Report, and there's more information available at these different links that I have provided here. I'd be happy to take any questions or comments.
Ms. Jackson.
I would certainly say congratulations on the work that we've done. My previous remarks still stand, but I do want to say I know that people work very hard, but we still have a ways to go. So thank you very much.
Yeah, I just wanted to comment back on page, I don't know what it is, but with the measures on English language arts and mathematics earlier and the different targets, you know, we see that overall the district is at 60.8% on English language arts, right? And 61.2% on mathematics. And I guess, and Ms. Jackson's already mentioned something about this, but at the same time that we have those high figures, I've heard in the last day or two that there are high schools with as low as 5% of the students proficient in math. Now, is that, if I don't want to say that publicly, if that's not correct.
We do have some in the single digits, and okay. This has been a long-standing issue where we see higher performance at the elementary schools, and then as grade level improves, it drops as grade level increases and precipitously at high school, unfortunately.
Right. I mean, in terms of, I guess, talking about an achievement gap, and we see it broken down here in terms of the different ethnic groups, and yet even among the ethnic groups, there's not, I mean, if we were to do an achievement gap between among high schools, it would be much more dramatic. Because if there is a high school that has 5% proficient in math, I would imagine that there's another one that's closer to 90%. I mean, I'm just guessing, but if the overall average is 61%, is my thinking correct?
I don't have real accurate numbers, but right. I know some of our higher performing high schools are in the 50 to 60%. So I don't know that we have any that are as high as 90%.
So. Well, the overall, all of the students, students totally are at 61.2%, right?
Right, based largely on the performance of our elementary schools.
Okay, that clarifies it, because that includes the elementary schools.
Yes.
Okay. So that's where the disconnect is. Okay.
Yeah, we know we have real challenges at the middle school and the high school with algebra and then with the other higher level mathematics courses.
Okay, so at the high school level, more in the 50 to 60 range is actually the high end rather than the average.
Yeah.
Okay.
Superintendent.
Yeah, I was going to add, John, just coincidental that Trustee Jackson and I had talked earlier in the day about the math issue, and she happened to have a spring 2011 math CST for our comprehensive high schools, and the range is from 2.4 to 57. And what I would say about this, it underscores the great differentiation across all of our comprehensive high school campuses. And if you think back to when we did the assessment for A to G, all the wide swing of access and equity across the schools and why we need to get to another level of raising that common denominator much higher as a whole for all the high schools.
Right, and I guess the reason I bring it up because this does bring out the difference between the different ethnic groups, but also shows that targeting specific high schools where all the students are there is going to have a big effect.
I wonder if either Ron or Superintendent or Dr. Meyer, you guys could comment a little bit about the potential waiver that's being proposed by the administration. How would that affect some of these metrics that we look at?
You're talking about President Obama's waiver of the NCLB.
Yeah.
Well, there are three areas that the president is suggesting. One is that you have to adjust your high school curriculum to show a balancing between your career readiness, CCRP, and your college readiness. And I think that, you know, we have taken actions and continue to take actions that would satisfy that particular element. There's a second piece that deals with evaluation processes. Something that we're not dealing with in specifics at the individual teacher review areas, but we are across the district in terms of a performance and working with the administrators. And the third area deals with turnaround strategies for schools, and I think that the President and Secretary Duncan brought out some of the previously identified strategies for Race to the Top, such as charter conversion, adjustments to staffing, teaching, and adjustments to principal leadership. We're arguing the case that we can achieve some of that with the community school reform model, and you know, we're prepared to say so in correspondence to the state superintendent, because over the next several months, it'll be at the state level where they initially address this issue, and I think in two out of three cases, we're doing some right things.
What is being waived?
Right.
I guess is the
right
question.
What are we becoming free from?
Yeah. There are 10 possible criteria that can be waived. I can certainly provide you a list of those, but I think, as Superintendent Koba mentioned, the strings make it very challenging for most districts in California to be eligible because of the issue about how teachers are evaluated and the use of student data as a substantial component of that.
But in other words, my understanding is that one of the primary issues is the waiver of these annual measurable objectives. Is that, so that under NCLB by 2014, every district, every school is going to be expected to meet 100% proficiency of every subgroup. And I understand that that's sort of the big one that, you know, folks are talking about.
I think the philosophical reason for the waiver is the desire to have a growth model as opposed to that stagnant goal.
Yeah.
Certainly both are valuable in certain contexts, but the interventions and punishment that comes with the other model is sometimes difficult for our schools if they want to sustain growth. So, for example, if they have to completely restructure their campus, it doesn't give them an opportunity to really put some time into ensuring that their growth model is working.
Yeah.
But it seems like what we're being freed from is, with a lot of these No Child Left Behind sanctions and rules, where, for example, we have a middle school that is is performing very well on the state tests in many measures as a distinguished school, and because of one subgroup, it's rated as a failing school. And so at the end of the year, that principal has to send home a letter to the parents saying your child is attending a failing school and has a right to go to another school. So it obviously our schools are going to continue focusing on improving the quality of education, but it's not under these narrow rules. And I think that the other thing that it does, if we're able to get these waivers and be freed from this, is it gives us more flexibility, if I'm correct, on how we spend some of the Title I money, which where we can actually implement programs to improve our schools as opposed to just follow some rote federal rules, right?
Yeah, that's correct. So, for example, the 20% set aside that we now are required to put for program improvement, school choice, and the tutoring programs, there would be some more flexibility to how we use those dollars instead of abiding by those prescribed ways that we must spend it right now.
And I also understand that there is the state issue in terms of what state rules are and which states would qualify or not, but there's also the possibility of applying for a waiver as a district. And for us to make a strong case about what we are doing about college and career readiness, what we are doing in terms of having a tight evaluation and support system and all the other measures that they're requiring.
Among the documents that were released by the president was essentially a requirements document. I'm still culling through that to see if indeed there are any reasons why a waiver from our district would be outright dismissed. But we're certainly looking at that to see if that's an option for the district.
Great.
Yeah, and I certainly support what Superintendent Koba is saying in that the first decision point, I guess, in the state is the state superintendent of public education, deciding whether to apply for a waiver on behalf of all districts in California, and I absolutely support the idea that we would be in communication with the state superintendent, talking about strategies that have proven to be effective in San Diego. The credibility of San Diego's position among the large urban districts, generally ranking at the top or near the top in most of these measurements, that if we're going to talk about strategies to improve schools, we've got some strategies in place that have shown consistent effectiveness over years, as opposed to one-size-fits-all strategies that may or may not have any basis in evidence for leading to any improvement anywhere. So I think we had talked about this, a couple of weeks ago. I think we're in strong position in San Diego to have a meaningful conversation with the state superintendent talking about absolutely California should apply for a waiver and should be freed up from these restrictions, and absolutely, San Diego Unified should as well. And the notion of, being able to demonstrate how we're going to continue to show improvement in exchange for those waivers is a reasonable one, but we've got strategies, and I think we need to be forceful in presenting those.
Is there, and I know it's hard sometimes when you look at specific school site levels, but clearly this systemic problem of the achievement gap, even as our overall growth of a district and even school sites have gone up, the gap has remained pretty much the same. There's been some change, some slight changes, but over the last several years, is there any sites on this district where the achievement gap itself has made significant changes and been reduced significantly?
There are schools for certain groups where that has happened. We can get you that analysis to show you where that has happened.
Because the real issue is, we can look at this district-wide and we look at overall growth, but if we are still not in fixing that achievement gap, that to me is the thing we need to focus on more than anything. And where it does work, that's where we need to expand that to other school sites in the district.
Yeah. I would definitely agree with that. I think, though, again, the way that we and everybody talks about the achievement gap, I do think is somewhat misleading, because What we're seeing is growth among all subgroups. You know, so in the slides that you share, Mr. Rohde, we're looking at the achievement gap between white and African American students, or between white and Hispanic students. And, you know, so we see, for instance, among African American students in mathematics, a growth of 35% to 45% proficiency, over 4 years. And we're seeing, you know, growth consistently with African American and Hispanic students at all levels. So again, the problem that I have with the way that this achievement gap is defined is, if we were to start where, say, white students were 20% proficient and Hispanic students were 10% proficient, and so therefore there's a 10-point gap, and then if, you know, you look down the road several years and white students are 100% proficient and Hispanic students are 90% proficient, there's still a 10-point gap, but there's been tremendous growth, you know, that's been made. I think actually talking about the achievement of African American Hispanic students as a percentage of the achievement of white students, or, you know, however we're defining the gap, I think is actually a little bit more of a useful way of looking at whether we're making progress. So, yeah, Dr.
I can point to a couple of places, however. This morning in the Union Tribune, there was an article that had a quote from Anna Diaz-Booz at Kearney's International Business Campus. And her school has the majority of the English learners on the Kearney complex. And when you look at the mathematics data that the superintendent was referencing, they are the school that scored second in mathematics behind Scripps Ranch High School. And so we know that they are making some gains and have won some awards that note that. And when we're looking at, as an area superintendent group, at some of the characteristics of these campuses and what commonalities they share. Often it's teacher collaboration, a focus, as we've mentioned, and then also engagement with the parents. And so these things we see very clearly. Sherman Elementary also had great gains. We saw with a population that is one of our subgroups that has put the district as a whole into program improvement. However, on this particular campus, they really focused in on the mathematics, honed in on what they needed to do, and made a difference at that campus. We've seen it with African American students this year at Patrick Henry. So if you look in the data pile that you have, I probably shouldn't call it a pile, but if you look at the
it's a technical
documents,
term.
What you'll see, the schools that made AYP, and one of the reasons we do want to at least look at that federal measurement, those are the students who had progress with all of their subgroups.
Yeah.
So it is an indicator that we have sites that are kind of breaking the typical data point that we might receive. So it is exciting to look through this, and looking at places that have broken the ceiling, it's very helpful for our team.
Great. Yeah, Superintendent.
And I wanted to add to what Nellie said about looking at best practices and examples and how we export those. In addition, I think the heightened partnerships with the Association of African American Educators and the blueprint that you all have approved and the action plan, and our alignments with the Latino Advisory Group, are both efforts to focus on this achievement gap. And bringing the area superintendents into a consensus team focus on what can we do across each of their areas to focus on kids of highest needs furthest behind in these gaps strategically. And I think that's a emphasis that's built even more so from last year to what we want to do this year.
All right, any further questions or comments? Thank you, Mr. Rohde. Thanks very much. Okay, can we get a motion to approve F2, our course of study for 2011-12? Any discussion? If not, please vote. I'm surprised that Ms. Jackson let that one slide by.
Yeah.
Okay. Can we get a motion to approve item G1, approval minutes for...
I'd like to have them all read.
Yeah.
I have to move to approve.
Second.
All right. Let's vote. And item H1, the Tiger Team update?
There's no report tonight.
No report? Okay. Item H3, excusing my absence from last week's board meeting.
Where did you expect that?
Excuse the absence for this week, correct?
We already...
Member Bison, you've already been excused.
Oh, I've been excused. Okay. This is
move right. Approval.
Well, thank you.
Second.
Move approval. Okay.
All right. Okay. All right. Item H4, Dr. Evans.
Okay. Right now, we are in the process. We've directed the superintendent, deputy superintendent, to develop a plan for school realignment, reconfiguration, and closures. These are all very difficult conversations, and Mr. Stover is going out to all the communities and the clusters and having this conversation. And I there's an item here I wanted to bring up, and I think there'll be another thing that follows from this, which is basically in terms of some potential savings from a school closure and how that would affect the community. And I think we need to give some direction to the staff on how to communicate about this. And the issue is that if a school is closed in a particular community, under Proposition S, we have whole site modernization funds for all of our schools. And so actually we will save, besides the operational savings, we will save money under Proposition S for that particular, what would have been spent at that particular school if a school is closed. And the item we've discussed informally is that because that we are getting the communities and the clusters involved in this conversation, that if a cluster is closing one of its schools and saving money at that school, that those resources of Proposition S should be redirected to other needs in that particular cluster in terms of what would be the advantage for that community in terms of closing that school. So under the motion which I put on here, this closure of some schools will result in Prop S savings by eliminating whole site modernization expenses. The board directs the superintendent to inform cluster committees that if and when closures and or realignments occur, other projects in the remaining schools in that cluster will be given priority for the use of those savings. This will allow the cluster councils to suggest how to redirect these funds within their community. Okay. And my reason for, and we have discussion about, but my reason for bringing this up is because Mr. Stover is involved in all these conversations with the community, and if this is something that the board agrees with, we should be discussing this right away so that clusters can take this into consideration when they're contemplating a potential closure in their school. And I think for full disclosure, too, Mr. Stover informed me that the recommendation of the ICOC was that any savings from a particular school just go back into the general pot of funds for Proposition S. And I appreciate their input on this. However, one of the things that I think that in terms of what we've been doing in school closures is really placing it more in the hands of the community, saying, you know, this community can only afford to, and it has 6 elementary schools, and we can really only afford to fund 5 schools. Do you want to find funds to continue the other one? Or are there projects that could enhance the other schools that would make it worthwhile in terms of closing one of the schools?
Okay. Can I speak now?
Yeah, so we've got a motion and a second. I just to understand the motion. By savings, you're talking about all potential savings, construction savings, operational savings.
No. I'm sorry.
Just Prop S. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
This is strictly Proposition S savings.
Okay.
No, because the operational savings go back to the district.
Okay.
Okay, and I certainly oppose this, and I oppose it because of the conversation the board had earlier at the repassed Prop S, and we started our first round of bidding. And bids were coming in low, and at that time we asked whether or not, when bids came in low, could those communities keep those funds? And the staff and the ICOC at that time had said no, because this goes into a general pot to make sure that we do the best for the entire district. Now, to bring this back up, and I understand why some communities feel that this is important and vital to them, but we are a unified school district. There are certain areas of this district that are pretty much built out. They don't have any more land to build on. They don't have any more land to sell. And what this sets it up for is that communities who schools may have to close or have properties that are in nice areas that we can generate resources, then that money goes back to them. And the reason, and I agree with the staff, and I mean certainly I was the one who said, let's take it back to wherever it, the community that ever, you know, whoever raised the funds. But we cannot start at this particular point, especially during our budget crisis, saying whichever area can raise funds can keep those funds. Because then what that does is it puts us in a difficult, in a different position, because the communities that can, again, sell land or generate revenue from land would certainly benefit, and those that are now have their schools that are highly impacted, they can't close a school and then sell the land off, you know.
That's not the motion.
But that's
well,
not the motion.
That's not even
so
close to the motion.
Let me.
The motion, well, the motion that you, that's here for me, that I'm reading here in black and white, says that if and when the closures or realignments occur, other projects remaining on the schools in that cluster be given priority to use of those funds.
Those savings.
And the motion then
Prop
is saying
funds.
The Prop S funds. I understand what the Prop S funds. I'm saying because we went down this road earlier. Earlier after we did Prop S. And what that says is, so let's take an area, and I use Claremont. Can I just try to use my example,
okay,
please? Thank you.
Okay. It's just that there's a basic misunderstanding what I said.
Okay.
So I think your objection may not be there if you understood what I meant.
If you're saying in this motion, and let me read it about, maybe I'm the one that's not understanding it clearly, but it says closure of some schools will result in proper savings by eliminating whole site modernization expenses. The board directs the superintendent to inform cluster committees that if and when closures and realignments occur, other projects in the remaining schools in that cluster will be given priority use of those savings. Let me finish. So what that says to me, and again, let me just try to use an example so then you can clarify if I don't understand this.
Okay.
So let's just take in Claremont area. Let's say we close a school in Claremont area. What I understand you to say is if we've had $100,000 set aside, appropriate funds set aside to modernize that school, that $100,000 now go to Claremont Cluster for them to use as they can in their cluster. That's what I understand this to be saying. Is that not true?
That's true.
That's
true.
The other comment you made.
But you made another comment.
And other things.
Okay. So and that was my answer. That reading that's what that says to me. And any other, you know, person that's reading it saying that $100,000 would stay right there in Claremont Cluster. So the concern that I have is that we're finding a way that in areas that now may have to close schools to find additional income for the schools in their community. And we, the previous board, I would have to say, when this item came up about if there are additional savings, whether it came from construction, if it's around Prop S, because now the economy is slower and some of our bids are coming in 30% lower. And what we were asking was if the bids came in lower, could we take those savings and put them back into those communities? At that time was when we had a conversation. The conversation was it is in the best interest of the district to put that money back into a central pot, because as time goes on and we may have to do other maintenance requirements, other refurbilization of buildings throughout the district, we will have those funds available. So I can't support this because, again, if we close a school and there's $100,000 sitting there that would have been used to refurbish that school, those money should go back into the central pot, because later on we may have to expand a school or we may have to help another school that's not in that particular cluster, and then we don't have the necessary funds maybe, you know, to do that. So I think it should go back into the central pot. So I can't support it.
Okay, Dr. Evans.
All right, I just wanted to make sure. I mean, we can have a difference about where this, the Prop S savings go. But there was a statement that you made about this, the property potentially being sold and creating money. That, I just want to be very clear that if there was maybe sold, maybe leased, other uses for the property, if there was any financial benefit from the use of a facility of a school that was closed, that would definitely go to the general district pot. That would not go to that. Okay, so I just want to make clear that sure that that's clear. And yes, the proposal is that we're going to community and saying basically we have, to me, there's a distinction between when bids came in lower on a particular project, because there was this auditorium or this stadium, whatever was going to be built, and they got the stadium, and if there's money left over, then that would be in the general pot. This is, again, saying to a community, we are asking your community to make a very hard decision about closing a school, and we want some cohesiveness in the entire community. And the way to do that is to say these limited it's not a huge amount necessarily, but the Proposition S modernization funds for that school would be utilized to enhance other schools in that district and in that cluster, and those very students who were going from that school that's closed to the other school would be, as well as the other students there, would be benefiting from that. So it would still, you know, it's almost like the, it's kind of a weird way of putting it, but it's like those Proposition S dollars are actually following that student. There may be a need for some enhancement at some of these other schools as a result of having these students go over there.
Mr. Barnett, did you want to?
Yeah, we're talking about three different pots of money. The first pot is if there's a whole site modernization, and we're actually talking as much as $4 million a school site. So the estimate is if you close 10 schools, it could be as much as $40 million freed up. So just so we are talking, not that $100,000 isn't real money, but we're talking even more real money.
Yeah.
That's one pot, and that's the pot that the motion says that the priority would be given to those savings staying in a particular community. And I'll give an example, a real one, since we've already, that's already been presented. The other night at Mission Bay, it was presented as an option that the Crown Point facility would be closed as a school and that the program would be moved to Bayview Terrace. And also the long-term goal of closing the facility at PB Middle and moving a, creating a an academy, 6 to 12 academy, essentially, on the high school site. So those two sites in there, roughly, would free up close to $8 million from those sites that aren't being used. Now, that doesn't mean that those sites, number one, the community may decide they want to expand joint-use parks for the community, or, you know, there's first requirement that there we look at public uses because the city may come in. Secondly, in both those cases, it's not unlikely that there will be additional construction requirements, especially say on Mission Bay, if you're going to add this middle school on a high school site. But then third, this is a carrot, if you will, among the what is so essentially for most communities just a stick of we're going to close this school. And this is a saying to the community, well, we are making decisions that are in the best interest of the district as a whole. The savings, the general fund savings of closing a facility will all go back in the general fund. Those savings are not being recommended by Mr. Evans or, as I know, anyone at this point, although maybe some clusters have raised this issue. If those savings will go back in the general fund because we have a general fund problem, those multi-year savings. The second aspect of rehabbing the site or doing a joint venture with a developer or whatever, if it generates revenue, at this point, Mr. Evans isn't suggesting, nor is anyone, that those new generated revenues stay in that cluster. But part of this whole strategy is to say we need to leverage our real estate assets, no matter where they are in the district, to generate more revenue for our ongoing budget problems. So those two, just to be clear, are not part of the discussion, at least at the moment. Although, as I say, some clusters clusters are saying, hey, we're losing the school, we should have some of the additional savings. This is obviously a difficult process. Last time the district went through this, I guess you had closed one school. We are looking at greater numbers of changes, but also I think the staff has been very creative in looking at not just closing to save money, but realignments that are creative, that work with the community. And this Prop S money does free up money that would be a sweetener to the bitter pill that communities are being asked to swallow.
I think that one of the issues that is getting lost here is that we are doing this. This is initiated because we are trying to close a budget deficit. When some of these schools close and these students have to go to other schools, it will cause some overcrowding. It will cause us to have to do some work in those other schools. The question then becomes, where does that money come from? And so that is the big issue, because when we looked at even just saying we were not going to do transportation anymore, we looked and said that San Diego High could not absorb all those students without additional work. We said that even Lincoln could not afford to absorb all those students without additional work. So in essence, what I kind of hear you saying is that, well, but the Prop S funds, they'll stay wherever they were intended to stay, and the district now will have to find another source, another revenue source to provide schools for these students. And there's no doubt in the southern part of the district, San Diego High area to be more specific, we need another high school. If we decrease transportation, and let's go to Mission Bay. Mission Bay is 80% of students bussed out from the southern part of this district. So what I also hear you saying is that we don't want to stop transportation, but we want to. Well, maybe you're not saying that, you know, but we want to make sure that if we have to close any schools or realign or our schools, then the money stays part of the money, the proper funds, whether it's $100,000. Or $4 million, it stays in this community to make our schools better. We are a unified school district. One of the items that our president even just did was talk about the shapes of our schools. And I don't want us as a district to set up a system where in the areas that we are realigning schools or closing schools have better school system than where the majority of our schools, our students are located at. So I cannot support this motion.
So this is a difficult motion. I definitely understand the reason for the motion and the argument that that a community is making a big sacrifice if we close a school in that community, and so we want to help offset that with resources to help that community. But I think Ms. Jackson and Dr. Evans have a similar goal, but it potentially this, but you guys are split on this motion depending on what happens to the students in the school that's closed. So Dr. Evans just talked about, in a sense, thinking about the money flowing with the students, so that if the school closes, and that school was going to have some repairs, some whole site modernization, and those students then go to another school within that cluster, that money, in a sense, would flow to the schools in that cluster that those students would go to. Ms. Jackson's talking about, a situation where the school might have actually a majority of kids who would go back into their neighborhood schools outside of the cluster and create a demand, for facilities, back in the neighborhood schools where students return. What I would be more comfortable with would be some sort of language in this motion that, for instance, if over half of the students in the school that was being closed stay within the cluster, that the Prop S funds would stay within the cluster. But if more than half of the students
return or leave the cluster and go to different clusters, then the money might come back into the general pool to help with facilities where the students are going. I'm also a little bit concerned, and I don't know if you intended this, Mr. Barnett, but I was a little concerned when you said the community might want to do something like have more joint-use parks or joint-use facilities. Prop S is intended to fund educational needs of students, and to the extent that a joint-use facility helps the students, that's great, and to the extent that it helps students and then helps the community, that's great too, and we certainly have supported a lot of joint-use projects. I would be concerned about a situation where a school would close and the cluster community, for instance, might want to use Prop S funds to create some sort of park or community facility in that community, which would be great, and we certainly need more parks and more recreation facilities, but it wasn't actually going to fund the educational needs of students. I mean, we can't suddenly become the parks department. So I would like to see some tweaking of this language to make sure that, number one, Prop S funds are always being used to meet the educational needs of students in the district, and that, number two, that I can support this concept if the majority of the students in the school that would be closed, actually remain within the cluster.
Yeah, let me comment on that. And even in my wording, which I put here, be given priority for the use of these savings.
Yeah.
I didn't try to make it an absolute.
Yeah.
And I also don't want this in any way to be a slush fund that's not for something that is, very strongly needed. In terms of the educational focus, there's Proposition S is the wording, and Proposition S has its mission, and it says project the remaining schools. So I think that already fits in there.
Yeah.
But I guess what I would be willing to modify it to, where it says projects the remaining schools in that cluster will be given priority if the majority of the students from that school stay in the cluster. And I would say, other project and remaining schools in that cluster will be given priority consideration if the majority of the students in that school attend other schools in the cluster.
I would support that.
Let's use Mission Bay High for an example. Right now, and you can correct me, Mr. Stover, if I'm wrong, there's about 900 residential people for both the middle and high school? I mean, I think that's the number you said at the meeting the other night. Is that?
Yes.
So, and right now, off the top of my head, I don't know how many are at Mission Bay, but we know 80%, almost 80%, do not reside in the community, and I'm not sure the percentage that don't reside in the
79% are transported in, 21% are resident.
And I don't know what that percentage is at
TB Middle,
but if this experiment could be fairly significant into combine those campuses, that could take a significant amount of money that is not in not available. Regarding the community park issue, we have to use Prop S money for Prop S projects.
Uh-huh.
Although the past board did approve a huge performing arts center at a high school here, which was not in Prop S and diverted money, and you could say that that's beyond the basic educational needs of certain schools. So even within Prop S, the past boards have looked at diverting funds on specific campuses. But the point is,
the performing arts center at Patrick Henry is for the students of Patrick Henry High School first and foremost. I mean, I think that's a silly argument that would not be educational use for those students.
It definitely will, but it's beyond what is needed or at any other site in the school district, and it's not in Prop S. The point is that you made a specific additional expenditure that was outside the language of Proposition S. And the point is, my district is going to have greater impact than any of you on the school closures if we're going to go ahead. And you know, if this is going to work, the community has to feel like they're not just being asked to make sacrifices, but there are benefits to the community for this. Well, and if you put an arbitrary percentage, I don't know, maybe that will work. Maybe it won't work. I don't know what the enrollment's going to be. And what if it's so? I think it needs to be more flexible than an arbitrary percentage with majority, because who knows, you know, in each of these campuses what it's going to be.
I mean, so if we take the example, as I understand what you were just laying out, and I know that this is just a conversation.
Right.
So the idea would be that Pacific Beach Middle School itself, the campus might be closed,
right,
and then Mission Bay High School would become like a 6 to 12
dual
campus.
Yeah.
I would think in that case, you know, most of the kids at Pacific Beach Middle School, even if they don't reside in the, you know, in the Mission Beach neighborhood, would then go over to the 6 to 12, and there would need to be an expansion of facilities. Well, that would be fair. That would make sense to me, yeah, to then use the funds that were designated for Pacific Beach Middle to go to, you know, expand the facilities at Mission Bay High School, because that's where the students are going. If those students didn't go to Mission,
right,
Bay High School, and if those students then, you know, were coming down to Memorial or,
right,
Wilson or wherever, there's going to be a need to create some space and some facilities to accommodate those students. And so that, you know, that's why I think there's got to be something in here which is about, you know, the money following.
I would move to table this item until Mr. Beiser returns, because I think he needs to be involved in the discussion as well.
That's fine with me. Well,
no, you don't. Move to table to express it.
Okay, well, we've got
a second
motion to table
until Mr. Beiser returns.
I mean,
and then so he can be
right
involved in this discussion,
yeah,
and maybe we can get some more data on the actual impacts of Prop S money freeing up and not freeing up, and look at the real impacts.
Let's go. I know Mr. Stover and Superintendent wanted to jump in, and so does Ms. Jackson. So go ahead, Mr. Stover.
Well, I would just comment that both scenarios are very, very likely,
yeah,
under the plan that we have going forward.
Mm-hmm.
Mission Bay will have to have some renovation done to accomplish this. They have their own $12 million of whole site modernization money aside from their athletic facilities that could be used for that purpose. However, the $8.2 million that would be saved from not doing whole site modernization at Crown Point and Pacific Beach Middle could go towards that effort as well.
Sure.
Now, there are also scenarios I would anticipate happening where we'll close a school and students will go to a different cluster.
Yeah.
And there will have to be some type of similar facilities renovation at the receiving schools. So I think both scenarios are very likely to occur under this plan. That's,
yeah,
all I would suggest.
Okay. Superintendent.
And I was going to, I think, build on what Phil said about we will have impacts both within the cluster where we may be consolidating or closing, as Trustee Barnett talked about, and to another cluster or two. This is a long construction period, over more years than we had originally anticipated because of the realities in the fiscal markets and in the construction industry right now. So that, and because of the uncertainties, pricing will change over time. When we talked about with the original board and taking savings off of a opportunistic or low spot for contracts, cycling it back into the larger fund, that was our rationale at the time. That still is a factor needs to play in there. We're also at a point in time where we're making adjustments. I think that it probably is a point now where we need to consider conditions around Trustee Evans's proposal here. It may be best if perhaps allow the Prop S staff to think about some of the issues, scenarios that may play out along with the closure that Phil's leading, plus having Mr. Beiser here to consider some of this.
Because, you know, and I'm not disregarding the fact that, yes, there will potentially need to be expansion. So if you're really going to go in this direction, it would probably make more sense, but I still think we should continue to say it would have a priority unless the funds are needed for
uh-huh,
accommodating,
like, yeah,
shifting of populations.
Yeah.
Because I realize we can't, but that doesn't mean necessarily we have to build a new high school.
No.
I'm not saying you're saying that, but it's been said we need a new high school. Well, you know, there are charter communities out there too, and you know, we have to look at all the options for serving the needs of our kids. So I think more thought into this and the impacts. Of course, we won't know until if closures happen, mm-hmm. what the impact will be mm-hmm. of, in some cases, especially Mission Bay, and mm-hmm. that we need to have the broader transportation discussion, too, on not only Mission Bay, but other schools, of as we face the budgets, of what will be the impact of continued reductions of transportation. We don't know yet, I don't think, what the impact of it was this year of the cuts we made. I mean, we've seen changes, but mm-hmm. we don't know why. Mm-hmm. So we need to determine that.
Yeah.
So I think having a more knowledgeable conversation of what the potential scenarios are and then makes more sense in putting it off.
What I would like to see, I mean, I think that the staff has listened to these proposals and can kind of work with it a little bit in terms of what might happen and where students might end up and what the different contingencies would be. But I would also like the staff to broaden the view a little, and I think what Ms. Jackson is saying is really looking at the long-term issue of where schools are now and where students live. I mean, there's a big, you know, disconnect. The problem is it's from here to here to here to here, and so there's all these little blocks when people start going back to where they live. But I think we need to, you know, we have a limited number of schools that the closure and realignment committee is looking at. I think that really needs to be broadened in terms of looking at the long-term issues. I mean, there are schools in some of the clusters which have not been put on the list for consideration, who have a very small number of resident students and a very large number of outside students. And so they're well enrolled and doing well and so forth, so it's not easily looked at in terms of doing that. And there are lots of reasons I understand why schools weren't considered. You know, it's been brought up about Lafayette has all of the equipment for the deaf and hard of hearing. Some schools have to receive for program improvement, at least for the next year or so. So, but I for us to be transparent, there was the issue of there are, you know, 30 potential that were considered and came up with 10 or 12. I think we need to put everything on the table, and because what Mr. Barnett is saying, if the other issue is how radically are we going to reduce transportation, and if it is significant, then that's going to affect where the students end up. It's all pieces of a puzzle.
Let me just jump that one comment. And then, you know, I don't think there's been any board member, Ms. Jackson, who's been more focused on reducing transportation to free up funds for other programs than I have, even though it will impact greatly my sub-district. But the reality is we're in a different budgetary world now, and we're facing significant problems in the future. I think it might be worthwhile to have staff survey those people who currently use transportation for choice or magnet and say, you know, the district is looking at all sorts of options in the coming year or years. One may have to be reducing transportation further. And maybe even have a self-addressed stamp return postcard that gives them three options. You know, if your transportation is gone next year, will you get your kid to that school? Number two, will you not get them? Will you go to a school in your cluster, or will you look at non-San Diego Unified alternatives? Because we don't know what the impacts of reducing transportation further will be on the decisions of the customer. I mean, if a parent says, I want my kid to be at Suzuki or Barnard or SCPA or whatever, they may just said, you know what, even if there's no busing, I'm going to get him there. Now, not everyone will be able to for financial and other reasons, but we don't know. And that, so it's very possible that even if we do reduce transportation further because of the terrible budget issues next year and the further years, that those programs, which I think we all value because they're unique and they're for so many reasons, they won't necessarily disappear because of the transportation. So we've kind of let transportation be the tail that's wagging the dog of our these other decisions without having any information to make intelligent decisions. I mean, you can say the same thing about Mission Bay. If you said to the parents, you know, you won't have busing in 2 or 3 years, what would you do? Would you still choice your kids in? And could you get them there? I mean, we don't know the answer. We're trying to predict behavior of customers that we've never asked them before. So I think, and that affects, obviously, the closure issue. If we're closing a school in one district because it's under capacity, but a lot of those kids or families are actually sending them by, for whatever reason, to another community, and you take away the busing. So I think we need to maybe, at least in a gentle way, tell the public that this is something that could happen. We need to have your feedback, and then that would help us at least in making our budget deliberations in the next 2 or 3 years and also the impacts. So I think we should do that on the transportation side, and that will affect this multi-year discussion we have.
Why don't we take kind of one at a time? So we have a motion on the floor. We've got another motion to table.
Unless you want to pull your motion, I'll pull the second. We'll just continue it to get more information, which is fine with me.
I'm fine with the staff having listened to all these topics that we've brought up and trying to get some information the next 2 weeks and bring it up, or 2 weeks, yes, and bring it up then.
Okay, so why don't we, Phil?
I just have a comment. Listening, you know, the single greatest variable that is out there right now that is an unknown impacting the decisions of the committee is the issue of transportation. Right now we are scheduled at the end of November to come to you with a 5-year plan as you requested of us. I'd like to get a sense of the board if you would be willing for us to bring that to you in October so that you could make that decision earlier, to consider the data, we can do the polling, talk about the impacts, because the impacts of further reductions in transportation will be much greater than the impacts to this point of reducing a much larger dollar amount. Hope that made sense.
Yeah, it does.
And perhaps it would help all of us if we held that discussion in October, the second meeting in October, instead of in November. Get your decision making, then the committee, because I had to tell the UC cluster, well, just last night, I told the UC cluster, we have no recommendations for closing schools. However, I have to be transparent with you and tell you that if transportation is significantly reduced in the short term, that may change. So I would like to get a sense of whether October, second meeting in October.
It seems like,
I could agree with October.
Yeah, it seems like we want to table this discussion to October 11th. It sounds like Mr. Stover is recommending that October 11th we have the 5-year plan discussion.
He was saying the 25th.
Oh, the second meeting in October. So maybe
because that's the time you need to do all this. Is that right?
Could we do an effective both postcard survey of everyone who uses transportation with three and questions and a place for comments and email? Because once again, this is not a poll. This is a true survey of our customers or users to see how they may react to this significant change. And it may be, obviously, it partly depend on what grade your kid's in.
So you're talking about a poll of all people using transportation, a survey, that is not mandated.
Choice.
Is not mandated by federal law.
Right, and see, I mean, because we really don't know what our users think at all, you know, and that could affect, you know, we still may have to make the same decision on based on budgetary reasons, but it would be nice when and if we made the decision, especially a 5-year plan, if we had some sense of what the impact would be to the users.
Let me suggest that what we do is we take this item, table it to the 25th, have the broader five-year plan discussion at the 25th. And we also ask, Mr. Stover to come to us with, kind of sketch out some ideas of what a survey might look like that Mr. Bryce.
But if you wait till the 25th.
That has to be done sooner rather than later.
We already know who is getting transportation, so it's
Why don't we appoint a subcommittee of the board to work, and I'd suggest maybe myself and Ms. Jackson on the survey of the question to at least work with staff on that, because I think the goal is if we can have that information on the 25th, then we can make a more intelligent decision.
Okay. Right. I don't want to do one before the other, so I think it's better to wait until the 25th and do it in a united package.
When you say one before the other, you're referring to?
Well, I mean talking about this issue of what's happening with the funds and what's happening with transportation, because it all fits together.
So first, we're tabling this to the 25th, and we're going to have this discussion with the broader discussion. Done? Agreed?
Yes.
Okay. Second, we're going to ask Ms. Jackson and Mr. Barnett to work with Mr. Stover and staff to develop some survey instrument of transportation users. That probably requires a motion.
I move.
I second the motion.
Your third part was that you wanted to look at the same time?
Yeah.
That was part of what we just did.
That will be based on the survey results, too.
Okay, so we've got a motion.
I seconded it.
And Ms. Jackson.
Are we all clear what the motion is?
We're also scheduled that night to give you an update on school closing, so it all fits kind of together.
Well, this will be a short meeting.
All right, the motion then on the table is for Ms. Jackson and Mr. Barnett to work with staff to develop a transportation user survey. All in favor?
Who voted for Beiser?
All right.
He's over there.
Good. So let's move on to our HR and finance monthly updates.
Lamont, if you come forward, please. Good evening. In light of the questions that came early in the comments, I think it is very important that we give you an update on the current situation of staffing. The first slide is our general slide of how many staff we have, monthly employees as of 8/31, and we can see the decline, which we know the causes of that. In terms of reduction of staff, both certificated and classified. And this is the breakdown in terms of our diversity. And we recognize that we're not doing a whole lot of staffing at this time in terms of going outside, but here's an update on the current breakdown. To date, we have 16 new staff that we have hired in SDA, 4 OTBS, and 1 POA. And this is the vacancy report that I thought would be important for you to see and how we have filled these potential vacancies. And I know there are a number of questions in terms of how many positions we have out there at school sites where we have folks who are on the recall list, and they're in a capacity of substitute teaching. And there is that reality that we have simply just received the numbers from the third Friday numbers. We normally do the fourth Friday. We recognized that we needed to expedite the staffing, and we attempted to do this for the second Friday, but we have decreased in about 1,700 students. From last year to this year, and so that was a factor in delaying the final allocations to the third week numbers, third Friday. So we do anticipate recalling a number of teachers. The staff did a great job. Ron's team today worked with the school sites, and we reconciled the allocation status report This evening I got a report from Debbie Foster. Her team, Ron's team, did a fabulous job of working with principals. We have all but 12 reconciled, and that's pretty good going into tomorrow. So we anticipate being able to push out the final allocations tomorrow. Then we're, our staff has been working with the school site principals to identify the vacancies, what I would call the true vacancies going into the 11 and 12 school year, which would then indicate the movement. We do know that there are a number of schools that are dropping in enrollment, and there will be a number of excess teachers from those school sites, a reduction in staff because of the numbers. And those teachers will need to have homes prior to us doing the recall. We'll do those simultaneously so that we can respect the impacts and effects language and try to get people back to where they were last year and maintain consistency in our school sites for our students. What we do run up against the reality, and as teachers spoke, we are, and as Trustee Barnett spoke and all of you, we are concerned about the benefits that are going to end coming up on September 30th. And as I shared with a representative from SDA, we're working with staff and the benefits office and brought this to you, that we want to make sure that we do not impact our staff that are recalled. And that's been very clear from all of us on staff and from the board superintendent. We understand that, and I'll continue to do that over the next 24, 48 hours so that we can at least comfort those who are in this situation that are going to be recalled.
Again, and just the other point there, Mr. Jackson, and I know that this is something that we've talked about several times. So teachers who are recalled at that point, you know, who are going to be higher than for you know, at least the year, we know.
Yes.
It's certainly our, you know, well, I would say propose it's the direction of the board to the staff, but I think the staff already agrees with this, that these, that people will not be brought on to temporary contracts for the rest of the year. People will be recalled into the status that they were in prior to their layoff.
That is correct. Yeah. We have a number of contracts that we have offered outside of the realm of folks that are on the recall list, and that is a reality that we've spoken about over the last couple of months. And we do use leave replacement contracts to balance our leave of absences.
Right.
We do have that provision per Ed Code. But those are, we're not talking about folks
yeah.
that you're speaking of.
Yeah.
The recall folks will be brought back. They will not lose salary. So that'll go retro to the day that they started. And they will, in a sense, be made whole
yeah.
As we have intended.
Including for the time that they have been substituting.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. All right, thanks.
Meaning, just so I'm clear, that in terms of what they were paid as subs would be reconciled?
It will be simply to state that on the day that they came back in this capacity as a sub, when they're recalled, it was like they're not even impacted.
Mm-hmm.
They will be brought back in a whole capacity.
Right.
So, yes, that would go back.
Right. Right. So we're focusing on them not losing their benefits in the meantime. And the difficult situation we were in was we need to bring them on as subs for a few weeks because we didn't know what the enrollment was going to end
That's
up being.
Correct. That is correct.
Okay. And just one little question back here on the employee diversity. It might help if we could have that broken out in terms of classified and certificated.
Okay.
Just because one of the issues has been particularly in terms of classroom teachers, and it would just make it a little clearer that way.
Absolutely.
Because I would imagine that the employee diversity among classroom teachers is not as great as it is among the in total employee.
And we can do that. I know I've done two groups, and I will break out the rest and provide that report to the superintendent. This is just a breakdown of the layoffs to date, both classified and certificated. I thought it was important. I know we've talked about this, and we've had a number of board actions to make adjustments to the staff that were laid off. And I also want to make note that it's important. I know President Barrera brought up the issue of the leave of absences, and if we can get folks who are on the recall list into those positions. And we will definitely utilize our staff who are in the layoff status, but we do consider the leave of absences just as we do all vacancies, and we want to keep that in mind. So that is there for you. Any questions?
Thank you. Any questions for Mr. Jackson? Thank you.
Thank you very much.
One thing here on the certificated layoffs. We have this high, just in terms of the timeline, and I don't know if you recall it, but we have the high number of 1374. A lot of that was corrected very quickly within a few weeks. So there's not as nearly as much discrepancy it looks at if we go a couple months forward, right, in terms of when people were laid off.
That is correct, Minnie, and I think that's a positive note. We do recognize that, I was saying probably 150 more with the reduction of enrollment. I'm not sure where that is in terms of the recall. I'll have a better sense later in the week. And as I stated, we're going to get the numbers out to the school sites, and we're going to work with our school sites to hopefully begin the process as early as Friday, as late as Monday, because the staff from the finance department has done a great job with the school sites to expedite the process of reconciliation. So we're hoping to be able to work that timeline to begin doing some recalls, as I said, early next week. But there will be a reality that number will drop, but there will be some at the end of the day.
So basically, at the end of June, we had 740, something like that, approximately 740 that were in laid off status. And since then, we have recalled 277, which puts us down to 466, and it's an undetermined number that will...
Brought back some in some key areas that we know, and this slide shows this, in terms of full recalls and some of the vacancies, some of the unique positions that we know we're going to need. So, yes, that number will drop, mm-hmm. but how significant, I don't know at this point.
Sure. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, board members. Thank you. Tonight we're going to present the financial update through August 31st. So this is for the 2 months of our current fiscal year. As you can imagine, there's not a lot of trends that we can look at in 2 months' time, and there's not a lot of interesting details at this point. So we're going to go through this fairly quickly and give you a large overview of where we stand currently. So the first page just reflects our 13 funds, the budget for each of those funds that you adopted on August 2nd, and then it shows you what's been encumbered with respect to expenditures and what's actually been expended in the first 2 months of the year. So if you look down at the bottom there, overall funds, we've expended and encumbered about $1.1 billion of a $1.8 billion district total budget. That represents about 61% of the total budget encumbered and expended to date. Just by way of comparison, this year, last time, we were about 65%. So we're on track as where we would expect to be this time of the year. The next column obviously is what's remaining in each fund, and obviously we use those two middle columns, the expenditures and the encumbrances, and the remaining balance to track what we call the spend rates, and that's what we report to you each month. So as we move forward, we'll break this down in more and more detail as the months progress. The next slide is simply the total general fund budget, and this is what's left. So once we've encumbered all the salaries and all the staff and the health and welfare benefits to go with those staff and the supplies expense that we know we need to encumber. This is what's left. So on the left, we have the general fund unrestricted. We have remaining about 13% of the unrestricted budget. And on the right, we have the restricted budget, general fund restricted budget, and we have about 18.2% left that has not been encumbered or expended. The main components of the balance, obviously, are the hourly salaries that we'll use as we go throughout the year, the benefits associated with those salaries, so those cross both the restricted and the unrestricted sides of the house, services and supplies on the unrestricted side, and books and supplies on the restricted side. This is a comparison year over year, spending as compared to budget. So this is looking at July and August of each year and what we've spent against the budget. So for example, general fund unrestricted in July of 2010-2011, we spent $38.3 million, or about 5% of the unrestricted budget. This year in July, we spent about $49.6 million, which represents about 7% of the unrestricted budget. These are obviously additive, so this would be year to date through August 31st, as we're looking at August then. What we're noticing is a little bit higher trending in the general fund expenditures compared to budget, and a little less in restricted. So at this point, we need to go back and dig further. My estimation is that there's some expenditures that are miscoded to unrestricted as opposed to restricted, and there's some other expenditures that have simply not been moved yet from unrestricted to restricted. So we'll look at that again closer next time and bring back some more details about that. And finally, this is simply a breakdown of the major programs in the general fund, what comprises the $1.1 billion budget, what we've budgeted and what's been expensed and encumbered to date, and again, what's remaining. So you can see that most of the programs obviously have balances from which to work throughout the year. The only one that doesn't there, I draw your attention to the other restricted balance. That's showing we have a budget of about $66 million. We've expensed and encumbered about $94 million. So it appears that we're over-budgeted or over-expended by $28 million. And that simply represents the chargebacks that we do in transportation and regular routine maintenance. As that work is done and those services provided, we bill those costs out to other funds and other departments. So that will even itself out in the end. And that's the presentation. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Yes, Mr. Barnett.
Now that we're starting into a new budget year, and I realize we do have issues of compiling real-time data, but we need to start receiving, even if it's bi-monthly, real balance sheets to show budget versus actual by department. Because this doesn't really tell me, where are we spending in police, where are we spending in school site, where we're spending in all these other areas, so we can get a sense. And so we really need to start having, once again, if you need to do it every 2 months because of whatever our data restrictions may or may not be, we need to start having data that will help us to understand the trends and then for making decisions into next year's budget. Because, this is so high level and it just doesn't. So I'm hoping that we could start getting true, balance sheet financial reports, if not monthly, at least bi-monthly. Do you see any reason why we can't get that in more detail?
I would offer that we can certainly break down the interim reports in more detail. So we could certainly provide the first interim and the second interim in detail by department and budget versus actuals by department.
You're saying when you say the first interim.
So the first interim, the first reporting, we have the two interims that we present to the county and the state. The first first interim, the report period ends October 31st. So that's when we're actually, it's kind of like our quarterly report.
2 months of school.
Yeah, so there's 2 months of school behind us. We can see some trends at that point. You know, the challenge, of course, is that even though the report period ends October 31st, it takes us some time to put it all together, and the board usually doesn't see it until December, the first meeting in December.
I can't wait 4-5 months to get a first accurate reflection of spending starting July 1. It's just we can't continue to make decisions this way. So we need to find a way to get more updated, real-time budget versus actual. As far as I have never seen any organization on the planet that operates this way, down to the PTA I ran to, you know, to city councils and all that. And we need to find a way, Mr. Superintendent, so that we can get real-time information of what our budget was and how much we've spent and whether they're over budget and why they're over budget or under budgets, and so we can get those decisions in more real-time than 5 months into the fiscal year. So, you know, maybe there's not an easy answer tonight, but this is just it's too broad and it's too nebulous, and I'm not going to go through another budget process like last year. I told you guys for 1 year I inherited it, but we need to have real specific, clear data, and for the public to see it. And so the departments can be held accountable, too, for their spending. And how can we hold them accountable if we're 6 months into the year and we're looking back in 4 or 5 months of data?
We can certainly provide you any level of detail you desire. The challenge is the format and the time. You know, standing up here and presenting every department budgets versus actual will simply be time intensive.
You don't need to present them
We can certainly provide you that information.
We can look at it.
And actually, when I began here about a year ago, we had more detail in these monthly reports, and we've sort of been moving to a more high-level approach, but we can certainly move back into the detailed approach if that's the board's.
I think the monthly budget versus actuals is if we can do that, I think that's great. And that's and you
sure.
did start
we
to
did.
Provide
that's
that
what
last
that's,
year.
Yeah. So we'll bring that back next time, and we'll certainly take some more feedback at that point, and we can certainly run some formats by the board if you prefer prior to then.
What Mr. Barnett is saying, I mean, for example, in transportation, we made huge changes and we were to make all kinds of savings. And are those savings really happening, or mm-hmm. did something happen with the fuel costs and so forth and so on? That's pretty vital information that can have a lot of variability.
Okay, any more questions? Mr. Little, if not,
thank you.
Thanks. Okay, item I2.
Move approval.
Let me get a second.
Second
declaration.
This is highly qualified teachers.
Yes, I'm up for all.
Okay.
I'm for all
right. All
qualified teachers.
That's right. And we've got an information report on our employee accountability analysis, Superintendent, item I3.
I'm going to turn this over to Phil Stover, who's been leading an assessment of the accountability programs.
Thank you, Mr. Koba. About 2 weeks ago, we provided each board member a binder that contained the findings from our accountability analysis. We did extensive interviews with staff at every level and did extensive digging into what our policies and procedures are related to accountability. The bottom line is we looked at three specific areas, and we found inconsistency in all three. And the first one being our evaluation policies and follow-up. Our determination was we have a lot of policies and procedures and contractual obligations related to evaluations of employees. However, we're following those policies and actually doing those evaluations very inconsistently. We have approximately 29% of our employees in the district who, after they survive their probationary year, are never evaluated again during their lifetime in the district by contract. That is a contractual thing with quite a few of our people, approximately 4,000 employees. Others,
who are those employees?
OTBS and OSS employees are evaluated only during the first year and then never again. So that's a huge gap in our ability to do ongoing evaluations. That would have to be solved by when we have a new contract, negotiating a plan for the evaluation of employees in that plan. Other groups that we do have the ability to do evaluations, we're very spotty on. We have categories such as permanent probationary employees. Those employees who are permanent because they've been in the district long enough to be considered permanent, but then they're brought into they're promoted or they're put into a new category. They then become permanent probationary and are required to have evaluations in the 5th month and the 11th month of that new status. That never happens. We're not doing that at all. That's a big gap in the sense of our overall practice. Budget accountability. We looked at budget accountability. What happens if a manager overspends in their budget area? What happens if a manager consistently doesn't take responsibility for their spending? And very inconsistent there, and I'm being a little generous. We just don't hold folks accountable, and this could be at the site or at a department head, and we have a list of recommendations in the document in that area. Third area was what we call daily interactions and decision-making accountability. Again, for our supervisors and our managers, directors, those folks, what happens when an employee does something, makes an error, a mistake, and that has a negative impact on the district? Or what happens when a manager or a supervisor has a rank-and-file employee or someone that reports to them that makes a mistake or needs counseling or needs guidance or needs direction? The overwhelming feedback that we had in that area is that our managers and supervisors, especially entry-level managers and supervisors, hesitate greatly to hold employees accountable. There is a sense of fear. There's a sense that they won't be supported by their superiors. There's a sense even that they may get in trouble for holding their employees accountable. So we have recommendations there as far as training for the most senior managers in the district on down, in the sense of providing a culture and a climate within the district where our employees feel free to hold their subordinates accountable. And that's not just in the sense of disciplining folks or catching them doing something that wasn't the best for the district, but overall in the sense of applauding the work of the folks, catching them doing something good, as has been said. We don't do that very well either. So all three areas that we looked at, we found spottiness and inconsistency from the formal evaluation to the "you did a really good job," or "let me just sit down with you and tell you how you could do your work a little bit better." What we're suggesting is that the board have a workshop where we could discuss this in much greater depth. Both our recommendations, we probably have 30 to 35 specific recommendations in each of these, well, not in each, total for the three areas, and we would like to get your input on that and give you greater degree of feedback than we can do in this report tonight. So our request of you would be to approve having a workshop on accountability to give direction to the superintendent and hear more about this effort and go forward.
Okay, and I think we certainly would want to schedule that. But I also, my guess is most of those recommendations are recommendations that the superintendent is more than empowered to implement. In other words, the board doesn't have to approve how the superintendent is going to implement an accountability structure.
Certainly. However, this effort began as the direction from the board.
Yeah, understood.
To staff to look at this. So that's why we felt the need to, or the obligation to report back to you.
Yeah. So maybe at the workshop, I mean, to the extent that you've identified some issues and you've got some ideas about what to do about that issue, you don't have to wait for the workshop, I guess would be my point, to implement those. You can tell us at the workshop what you've implemented.
It's a report.
Yeah, it's a report. Yeah.
It's a report,
yeah.
Not an approval. Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Also, if you wouldn't mind, we had an audit committee the other day, which is going to be, and it was looking at specific areas where the audit committee maybe found that a deadline, if it had been missed, we would have lost a couple million, which was mentioned the other day, or in some cases, we actually lost several millions of dollars because things were not done. We're also looking at issues on the sites, and the audit committee was actually recommending that there even be some financial penalties, if possible. Like, for instance, a school site. If there is mismanagement of the funds, who's accountable? Well, hopefully, it's ultimately the principal that there should be some consequences for those things. So we need to look at having real accountability. But obviously, we want to make sure people are trained properly and have, because people have different skills. But so I think looking at what some of the things they were looking at would fold into there. Secondly, I agree with Mr. Barrera, is that our primary focus is the education of our kids. Primary focus is accountability at the school site and the education. And we've made it very clear that we want the superintendent to hold the deputy superintendent for education, who holds the area supes, who holds the principals, who's responsible for that site, accountable. And I'm hoping we're actually going to see a plan. Not just that create a plan, but there's going to be a plan that is implementing, so at the end of this year, we can monitor and measure that, because that's what the board has said that it wanted, and I agree, we don't need to give further direction to that. We said this is not the year of the rabbit or the goat or whatever it is, it's the year of accountability. What year is it anyway? Oh, okay, what animal is it? So I ditto what Mr. Brewer said.
Couple comments. One of the things that we said last year, and it came up, I'll pick on a couple of areas. One had to do with area superintendents and the whole issue last year, and we reduced the area superintendents, and on what basis are area superintendents being evaluated. And I believe as a board direction, and it may have been a comment by me, I get confused between the two, but the whole point of making public early in the year on what basis both for the benefit of the area superintendents and all the staff and the public, on what basis are they going to be evaluated? And that's just taking one example out of thousands of employees of the district, but it's a very clear way of showing that the district is taking, you know, evaluation and accountability very seriously. So that might be part of the workshop or something to talk about that. And then just commenting on another area in terms of teacher evaluation and accountability. We hear a lot of times when it comes up about layoffs and seniority and who are the good teachers and who are not as good and so forth. And talking with a lot of union members have told me, you know, it really is the responsibility of management to evaluate the employees and hold them accountable. And so I think we need to just make it really clear to staff and to the public that we are actually doing that, so that whether there's a layoff or not, we're keeping track of who is doing a good job and who is not and what needs to be remediated. So just as Mr. Barnett said, I mean, we evaluate the superintendent regularly. He evaluates the deputies, the deputy to the area superintendents. We have evaluation systems in place, which we've been a little more specific that we know about for the principals, and then the principals supporting the teachers. So I think that if everybody can see that this is done on all levels, and obviously people are going to be more supportive of it, if they don't think that they're singled out in some way.
Just very briefly, and certainly, we thank you for the report, and I think that, and hopefully, I do agree that a lot of those things can be implemented by the superintendent. We have said, the board has said, time and time again, that we want to hold the superintendent accountable. And this morning I told him, I said, I will hold you accountable for what's going on at one of my schools. I said, either you know, because that's what we said as a board. But the bottom line is that there has to be some report that comes back to the board that lets us know that we have some system of accountability. My concern is that, now I don't remember all the recommendations that you made, but certainly when we talk about, you know, holding principals accountable to be in their classroom, I can only go from things that I picked up over the years visiting some of these school sites. I've been to school sites where in the principal's office there's this big board and he's showing who's going into what classrooms when, what they're finding, what they're following up on. So at any given time, the principal can tell you, we're visiting our classrooms, yada, yada. I've been to other school sites that say, you know what, Ms. Jackson, you know, we just go in there. Okay, so now the difference becomes if the school that is visiting the classrooms is improving and the one that is not, you know, the area superintendent is saying, I want you in the classroom, how is that documented and how is that monitored? Because what when we say that we're going to hold the superintendent accountable, if he is telling the deputy superintendent to do X and that person is pushing it down to the area sup, to the school site, the school is saying, well, you know what, I have my way of doing it. Okay, and but if that way is not successful, the question then is who is held accountable? And I used the example this morning with the superintendent about the math. The math scores, the question is who is accountable when you see that the math scores in the district are declining? Okay, is it now the principals and the teachers? Is it the area sup, deputy sup? We even have an office of instruction, you know, with Dr. Salazar over it. Where is his role in this? Okay, somebody is responsible for monitoring all of that, and is those people doing their job? So when you look at the accountability piece, we have to be willing to say who is accountable for what, how is that measured, okay? So if we say, in this case, and I just used it math with Mr. Salazar, if we say that we look and see, and it's not up to me as a board member to say, hey, look at our math scores, let's get that clear. I think that that is responsibility of the staff. So someone in this district, and it shouldn't have been me, and I told him this morning, I said, you should have came to us, to me, or community, and said, we see this disparity here. This is what we're going to do about it. That tells me that someone is accountable, someone's working somewhere, because it didn't get picked up by accident by a parent. It didn't get picked up by the school board member. The staff is monitoring our system enough to find out when there are deficiencies. On the audit committee, for years, we would say, people aren't spending their funds right, they're going over budget, what are we going to do about it? And the poor internal auditors say, well, all we can do is tell you. You know, we're not the ones to evaluate the principals. You know, we don't get into any of that. So the internal auditor person was doing their jobs by going out and doing these audits. But the people that were being audited, that was being caught, there was nothing happening. So people said, well, so what if I go over? So what if I spend incorrectly? Well, you know what? I did last year, and guess what? Nothing happened, so don't worry about it. So that has caused this culture of people feeling that they're really – there's a word of accountability, but there really is no accountability. So as you bring this item to us, whether it's a report or however you want to put it, it has to be something that is very transparent so that people can monitor it, so then people have a question, and we say, you know what, who's responsible? Because the bottom line is this. We're not going to fire a superintendent because one school out of 200 is failing. That's not going to happen. The board majority probably won't do that. I might say that, but the board majority won't say that. But we have to have something that says everyone, and that someone has to be held accountable for making sure that each and every one of our schools are successful. And if they're not, then we have to have something that holds them that says, you know what, the reason this happened is because this didn't happen, and we're going to counsel that person, do a letter with that person, whatever it is. We don't know. I mean, I should say we don't. I don't know. Because when people ask me, they say, well, we had this concern, what happened to it? I say it's a personnel issue. That's all I can tell them. It's a personnel issue. It's being resolved. But we have to have something that lets them know it is resolved. And they're not feeling that right now. They're feeling like we bring up issues and it goes to the Ed Center and poof, you know, everything goes along. I'm sorry. It's one of my areas here.
Superintendent.
I think that what we're trying to do with this report and the workshop and the recommendations is to make a very significant cultural change. Things that have been shared with the board are right on the mark. I mean, we went from what's the assumptions about the accountability to this report, and when we sit here and tell you that we don't even have a consistent requirement across the collective bargaining groups for annual evaluations, that's a first point that has to be fixed. I think what Phil did was try to dig below just a process for evaluation to say that, you know, we have a very spotty record on how people are held accountable for their funding. And that is another area that we want to, I think, stop. I mean, the very embarrassing ASB report that came out 2 weeks ago, I'm not afraid to talk about that in public. I told the director of internal audit, who now reports directly to me, that the next time he comes across in its initial investigation that a ASB report is going down the tubes, we're going to stop the we're going to stop the audit and begin an investigation right there and then on the spot. And I think that kind of cultural change has to be emphasized. We have training coming here next Friday for the principals to talk about what I'm calling the principal minefield for managing facilities, for funds. And it's not one single group. It's the entire organization that needs to be attuned, sensitive to what we're trying to do in managing, whether it's academic outcomes or funds, or everything in between. So with a consistent push on all levels by all leadership, whether it be the board or the senior leadership, we have got to get there. And talking about building metrics to hold people accountable, we've just gone through that requirement with the cabinet and the area superintendents, asking each of them, how do you want to be held accountable? How do you want to hold your people accountable? What do you want us to measure? In just starting to create a set of these are going to be the measurable, accountable focal points for this year. We've started, but we've got to put our words into actions, quite frankly, and it will take us a period of time to reinforce, to train, and to get people to make good ethical decisions, and or when they are put in a corner, to be able to speak up without fear of any kind of retribution. And all that works together, and I think that the staff is ready for that. We just need to go there and take the action.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for that analysis as well, Phil. Yeah. Okay, so we pulled items E4 and E21 from the consent agenda. Item E4, Ms. Jackson.
Just very briefly, yeah. My concern is not particularly the item, but how this item came to be. And the funding for this item came to be because of the freezing and unfreezing of funds at the end of the school year last year, which caused us to have extra ARRA funds, which are being expended tonight. My concern, as I shared with the superintendent and deputy superintendent, was that the people that originally had these funds were not afforded opportunity to spend them because they were told your funds are frozen, you can't spend them. And then this year, when they realized that they had an overage, we had to spend them by the end of this month, which puts people in a crunch. And what I get concerned about is it's not the first time that the staff has frozen, unfrozen categorical funds. And I don't want the staff to get, this is the second time that I know that they've done this. And what happens is it creates these extra funds that then people can go off and spend the way they want. No offense, they can go off and spend the way they want versus the way the board had authorized them to spend the funds. So that is the concern that I have about this particular item, is that the funds are not being spent the way that the board authorized them, and not because of the deputy superintendent, don't get me wrong, but it's because of when we were going through our budget crisis, people trying to hold on to, you know, to money and saying you can't spend these funds by the time it was released. The school year was out, and then all of a sudden we have these funds that we have to expend in a hurry. And I just have concern. I don't want this to have to do it again this year, which is my point. I don't want them freezing categorical funds and then releasing them at the beginning of next year and saying, oh, how can we spend them now? I want them spent for the way that we say this year.
So this is something we've gone back and forth, because Ms. Jackson has raised this issue in the past, but my understanding is that we never froze categorical funds. But was that true or not true? I mean, what was the, you know, what we did a spending freeze, you know, actually 2 years ago,
Yeah.
I'll provide a little clarification from the budget side.
Yeah.
We never, in the past year, we have not frozen any categorical funds.
Yeah.
And I agree with Ms. Jackson. We probably could have done a better job at communicating with the
uh-huh.
schools that they had until such and such date to expend these funds. So these funds were given to the schools years ago. We were encouraging schools to use these funds by June 30th of 2011, because we knew that the September 30th deadline was looming and that schools probably wouldn't have time to expend those funds when they got back to school in September of this year. So these funds particularly were available, and I think there's about $95,000 of unspent funds, ARRA funds, at the site level. So it certainly is part of this money. It's not all of it. So we could have done a better job in communicating the urgency of spending those funds, but they weren't frozen.
Okay, so Ms. Jackson, will you move approval of this issue, or you want? Yes.
I just want to share that there were central funds that, in fact, did receive the message that June 30th was the cutoff, and I believe an error was made in that case. And as a result, we had two departments that had started to charge other funds for the month, for July 1st and August, for some professional development that occurred. And then what we did in conversation with Board Member Jackson is went back to those particular departments and let them know that they had an opportunity in the month of September to spend the money. And then we looked at what was remaining and tried to align it as much as possible with the LEA plan and met as a group to decide what would be the best use of these funds. And therefore, we came up with this board item.
Okay, so do we have a motion to approve this item?
So moved.
And a second? Second, Mr. Barnett. All in favor? Okay, great. And item E21?
Yes, and I pulled this not so much that I have particularly concerns or objections or significant questions about this particular lease, but I think as part of the whole process of reviewing all our assets, we need to take a breath before renewing all leases and saying, is this meeting our new paradigm of maximizing revenues within, you know, other criteria and constraints? So I guess what I'd like to suggest is, and I know nothing about the details of this, and I don't necessarily want to get into it, but I would think, and I know you're doing a real estate proposal coming up October 11th, but I'd like to suggest that we, if much as possible, put off extending leases, especially for 5 years and then another 5 years beyond that, until we kind of look at, we should reevaluate them and say, is this, if this meets a true academic purpose and need, then great, then, you know, it's fine. Or maybe there's another site that works better for this particular use, whatever it may be. And, or is there ultimately, do we have a better way to leverage that asset for us as opposed to this particular use on this site? And once again, I'm not picking on this item. It just happened to be an item where we're talking about extending a lease 5 years with a five-year option. So I guess I'd like to suggest that we hold off on anything until we have the broader real estate asset discussion.
I can
if
agree.
That's yeah. Unless in this case we can't, maybe.
Yeah, I agree completely. This item is not for the extension of a lease, however, and I can let the folks here clarify it. You did that back in June. This is clarifying some legal advice that we have related to subleases within that extension. But having said that, I concur completely that we need to look at these very carefully, and that's why we're bringing you a recommendation for the real estate department that would enable us to do that.
Okay, so this is we should proceed with this tonight, then, you're saying? Okay, so with that understanding that we'll...
Right, it's just a clean-up about some subleases.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Is that a motion?
Yes.
Okay.
Second.
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
to approve the staff recommendation. Okay.
We... It's a French school, so I'm trying to use my multilingual skills.
We've got one speaker, Michelle Jeanette.
Yes.
Is Michelle Jeanette still here?
Nope. Okay, then we are adjourned. Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah.